Information and Communication Technology, video for grade 11 English medium ICT students. Now you are going to learn about unit 2 system development life cycle. Okay students, first you should know about a system. So I'm going to explain what is the meaning of a system. A system is a collection of components that interact to achieve a specific task. Nowadays, we use many systems in our day-to-day life. Let's consider some of the examples. Computers, automated teller machines, fingerprint machines, robots, QR code systems, and also smart devices. Let's see about a computer as a system. If a computer system that does not have interconnected parts, we cannot use it for our purpose. A computer can be considering as a system in which that parts are properly connected. It's also possible to use this system for work in order to achieve the goals. Okay students, let's see basic elements of a system. Every system has three basic elements such as input, process and output. Here input received by a system and convert into output by processing. Consider the hospital as a system. Here system is a hospital, objective healthy society, input obviously patients, process treat patients using the hospital's interconnected resources, output providing healthy human being to the society. In the same way, you can write input, process and output for the school system. Okay students, now this is your task time. So you should write objectives, input, process and output for the following systems. First one is school system and other one is library system. Okay, let's see what is the meaning of information system. A system which converts data into information is known as information system. Information systems can be classified into two categories. The first one is manual information system. Another one is computer-based information system. In a manual system, all processes are done manually. Let's consider the examples for that. Let's see manual system in a small shop at a small village. Here I mentioned how to carry out manual system in a shop at a small village. In this system, all the activities are conducted by the human beings. So this system depends on human. The shop owner records the details using book and he writes the details of the goods such as name, cost, price and number of goods received. The sales price for the goods will also be recorded in the book. At the end of the day, profit or loss report will be written down. The input process and output here are as follows. Input, the name, price and quantity of the goods. Processing, registration of the goods, providing appropriate selling price for the goods. Output, report about profit or loss for the particular day. Let's see what is the meaning of computer-based information system. A system which converts data into information using a computer is known as a computer-based information system. Consider a computer-based shop information system. Some of the benefits are as follows. In a short time, that shop owner can know all the details of the particular item, such as price, number of received, date of delivered. Identify items using the barcode system. Other one, you can easily get a profit or loss accounting details. Then information can be stored safely in a short space. Okay students, you can refer page number 56 in your textbook and write the major differences between manual and computerized information system. Here I mentioned a single difference between manual and computer-based system. So, in a computer-based information system, data can be processed more efficiently. But in a manual system, processing of data is less efficient. Okay, students, you should pay more attention for this area of the unit because of your O-level examination. To develop an information system, there are different methodologies are available, but the most popular one is system development life cycle. So the following are steps of system development life cycle. First one is identification of requirements. Second one is designing the solution. Third one is coding the solution. Fourth one, testing and debugging. Fifth one, deployment of the solution. And last one, maintenance of the system. Okay boys, now I'm going to elaborate identification of requirements. This is the first step of the SDLC and important one also, because every new system based on a user new requirements. So we should identify new requirements of a system. A complete investigation on the existing manual system or the computer based to be delivered is carried out in this phase. Aspects such as objectives, benefits, efficiency are constructed. This is carried out in collaboration with the staff of the organization and the development team. At the first stage, information collection is most important one, because to study existing system extensively, to identify new user requirements, to fulfill the needs of the user. Nowadays, we can use several methods to collect information such as observation, interviews, questionnaires, document sample collection and prototyping. The second step of SDLC is designing the solution. Let's discuss about this with an example. Just imagine, after identification of user requirements, you want to convert your manual banking system into computer-based system. At this stage, you conduct actual design of the proposed system. Some activities related to design process are as follows. First, you should identify available software and their architecture for your proposed system. Thereafter, design user interfaces, that means what the user sees on the screen. Then you have to conduct preparation for data storage, like database. Then you should conduct identification of main hardware systems and its components. Next, identification of dependency of each subsystem. Thereafter, deciding on the required hardware and software to run the system. Designing structure for software, databases and user interfaces. Finally, you should conduct planning of test. The third step of SDLC is coding of the solution. The main objective of this stage is coding of the proposed system using a suitable computer language. Making the code simple and efficient enables one to develop and understand easily. A well-written code makes it easy to read and understand and reduce maintenance cost also. The fourth phase of a SDLC is testing and debugging. The main objective of this phase is to resolve errors. Errors in coding, errors in planning and errors in requirements are corrected. There are several methods to test a system. Some of them are as follows. First one is unit testing. Here each unit in the system is tested independently. Second one is integration testing. Here units are integrated to form the complete system and integrated system is tested at this stage. Third one is system testing. The complete system is tested for its outputs for the given inputs. Last one is acceptance testing. This type of testing carried out at the last stage of testing. In this testing, user is allowed to use the system. User can proceed suggestion also. The fifth phase of a SDLC is deployment of the system. Deployment of the system which has been tested and debugged is carried out at this stage. There are different deployment methods are available. They are as follows: direct deployment, parallel deployment, pilot deployment and phase deployment. Now I am going to elaborate all the deployment types. First, direct deployment. The old system is totally terminated and the new system is installed. The second one is parallel deployment. Old and new systems are used parallel for a certain period. Pilot deployment. Here using the newly developed system in a selected area. If new system was success, it will apply for whole area. Then other one, phase deployment. Here apply the system stage by stage and success with each stage leads to the next and in completing the new system. The last phase of the SDLC is maintenance of the system. A system once installed, it needs to be maintenance well because the computers, softwares and networks are all maintenance in this manner. With system maintenance, the following may be required. The first one is developing system to suit new user requirements. Second one is issues that surfaced with the use of the system which were not identified during the system development. Third one is adopting new technologies into the new system to improve efficiency. System development life cycle models. There are several models of system development life cycle. Each model facilitates the system development in different ways. Some example models are as follows: waterfall model, iterative incremental model, prototyping model and spiral model. Let's see what is the meaning of waterfall model and its features. First, identify requirements. Complete one stage before going to the next phase. The result of the developed system is found at the final stage. This is waterfall model. The characteristics of the iterative incremental model are given below. Read them and get knowledge about that. You can refer page number 63 for that. Answer the question given below. I hope all the students will answer all the questions given in the video. Thank you. Goodbye.